Have you hugged a right bin? Wagered a podcast bet? Toasted to friends at Clover Pine? Prove it all to your friends with CrossFit merch available now in the gift shop. T-shirts, hats, mugs, stickers, and a whole lot more. Your purchase supports the show and keeps us running. Go to GhostbustersHQ/shop to get yours today. I like that shirt, friend.
This week on the program, we're catching up on all of the news that we haven't talked about in the last couple weeks, including some family featurettes, Ghostbusters 2, the score album being delayed, some merchandise stuff, a whole lot of fun. Then we're also going to be talking about the Hughes and Thrall demo that was done for the original Ghostbusters film. And if you're a fan of the Marvel movies, you might know, stick around until the end, because there might be a little surprise waiting for you at the end of the show. Stay tuned.
Still Playing With Toys presents the Ghostbusters Interdimensional Crossroad, the biggest podcast since 1909.
So free.
News, interviews, and commentary on everything Ghostbusters.
Are you the key master?
Here are your hosts, Troy Benjamin and Chris Stewart.
You know, it's just occurred to me we really haven't had a completely successful test of this equipment.
Oh, we have fun. Woo!
Handed it off to the girl, become Star Girl. And then they made the TV show out of it. And then they get the second season. And great, because they kind of TV reinterpret, bring back the Justice Society. Yeah. They reference the original old Justice Society, and everybody's like, yay! And then she kind of rebuilds her own, which is sort of like the comics, sort of not. Yay! And then second season, it's like, yeah, what is it with the Wilson brothers, by the way? It just occurred to me. Comic nerds? What the hell? Luke went with DC and Owen went with Marvel. Oh, man. Thanksgiving's going to be really uncomfortable.
I know. That's, opposite ends of the table here.
But anyways, yeah, so the trailer reveals that Shade shows up in the second season, and I'm just, as a fan of that Starman run, I'm like, ha, 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 ha. So it's been a good day. I didn't realize it was a Picard one.
Picard trailer. No huge spoilers because we know he's coming, but Q shows up in it, and I did that same sort of gleeful manic that you did.
Mm-hmm.
But it's been a good day. And
then to top it off, Thomas renamed the bug-eyed monster, the bug-eyed ghost. So.
Oh, what is his name for him?
Yeet Yo Eye.
Yeet Yo Eye.
That's... No, Yeet. Yeet.
Yeet. Oh, okay.
As in Yeet.
Yeet. That's pretty good. That's better. I mean, Hazel's Steve Danvers, the translator, is still... I'm kind of... I don't know where that came from. But that's pretty good. I like that. Well, hey. Hey, everybody. Welcome to the Crossrip. As we're talking about Stargirl and Star Trek and Loki and all of these things, and everybody's like, are we listening to Yes Have Some? Nah, it rubs off on us a little bit. We get to talk to the YHS guys, and then we're like, what are we
talking
about?
We can like other
things. But there's plenty of Ghostbuster stuff to talk about, that is for sure. And I know if you're tuning in, you're chomping at the bit saying, why have you guys not talked about blank? And fear not, we will be talking about it this week. So without any further ado, we're going to spoil Loki episode 2. Here we go. Just kidding. Here we go with the news.
Hey guys, Peter. I have some news from the world of Gozer.
I got some pretty cool stuff cooking up over here if you want to just turn your head.
Multiplanar curly emanations.
Now, well, here's your next month's cover of GQ. Check out the aura on this sucker.
All right, Chris. Well, happy 32nd birthday to Ghostbusters 2. That's as we record today on Wednesday, it is the actual anniversary. As you listen to this on Monday, you'll be like, that's old news, gentlemen. But I figured we should mark it just to raise the glass and say happy birthday, happy 32nd birthday. You don't look a day over 25 to Ghostbusters 2. We have some classic original Ghostbusters stuff to talk about, but I kind of want to dive into the Afterlife stuff first, if you're okay with that, Chris.
Sure.
So, and I think that's what everybody is very anxiously awaiting. We're all so excited. Ghostbusters Day is in the rearview mirror. For all the people that were looking forward to a trailer, don't worry, it's coming. Just stay calm. But we did end up getting a featurette right after we did our live stream with YHS and talked about everything that happened on Ghostbusters Day. They kept the party going like for days. There was some home entertainment stuff. They put up some sales on all of the classic Ghostbusters on video on demand on Amazon. One of the best deals I've seen on a real Ghostbusters set in ever, like $20 for 100 episodes, even though it's not complete. I mean, that's still crazy. That's such a great deal. But this past the Proton Pack featurette came out, and I feel like I wish that would have come out for us to talk about on that crossover we did with Yes Have Some, because it was great. It was such a wonderful featurette. It's an interview with Jason Reitman and Ivan Reitman, and as we've come to understand, this was supposed to be released last Ghostbusters Day, and for obvious reasons, the movie delay, COVID, everything that was going on, June of last year, it was delayed to this year. But some new shots in there, some fun things where we're getting to see just the heads or the tails of shots in the trailer that we haven't seen before. So Phoebe goes down into that underground secret lab, and we see that her mother is in there with her. Oh, fun. I want to know more about that scene.
Yep.
And some Easter eggs, including in that scene, I think it was Jason at Ghostbusters News pointed out that there was a Cheez-It box sitting on one of the desks in the background. So somebody in there loved his junk food still, huh?
Go ahead.
Oh, I was going to say, I wanted to get your impressions of it, because it was just a wonderful and a very heartfelt interview with the Reitmans talking about how it was a family film. But what were your impressions of that featurette?
It was good. I liked it. And actually, I noticed a couple of the shots were recycled from that Sony video that came out.
Yeah, they're
3 or 4 weeks back. They're, I forget what it was called, but it was very much a Sony State of the Union video that they kind of put out to the world.
They've done a couple of those. Like, they did one where it's like, here's our commitment to, the better the world at large. There was that video. Then there was also the video that we did talk about with Yes Have Some, where they talked about the behind the scenes of Ghostbusters using that spatial reality screen.
Yeah, but that Sony one, whatever it was for, had a couple of shots like what do you call it, Video Alley or whatever. Jason sitting
Video Village. Yeah.
Video Village. Yeah. Video Alley.
I like Video Alley. Why is it not Video Alley? I like that a whole lot better.
Video cul-de-sac. I guess it really depends on where you set it up and how easy it is to get to it. But
and do you have a wall of monitors on either side? Then you got a Video Alley. That's how it goes.
There you go. And we tend to try not to speculate, but the background, a couple of those shots looks like, I don't know, kind of temple-esque. Does that make any sense?
Yeah, there's one that's kind of temple-esque. There's one that's very clearly that industrial area that we see in the trailer where Jason Reitman's title card comes up. We say recycled, but it's probably they pulled from whatever the EPK clips are that are, you know, currently available that Jason Reitman has approved, because he doesn't want anything out in the wild. So whoever's cutting all these pieces is like, well, we have the same 5 minutes of footage that Jason will let us use. I guess let's just go with that.
So what we take away from that again, one fits in with what we've seen before. So it looks like, what little we know, that the kids try and chase down Muncher ultimately includes going into that. I think the very first teaser we got, didn't we see Muncher kind of?
We saw like a
suggestion of him floating in the industrial space.
Yeah.
Now we see, we got names now. We see podcasts. So we see Logan Kim in there with talk. So we know the kids probably end up going after him at some point. And then, like I said, the big question mark, and it's not even much of a question mark. I don't think it's too huge of a leap to say that anytime you're going to enter a mind owned by the Shandor corporation, it's not going to be a little weird if it's culty temple-y down there. So I'm kind of wondering if maybe that's what we got a sneak peek at. I'm not going to put any money on it. I'm not going to speculate too much, but that's kind of the impression. And frankly, good enough. Here's your June ration, Chris. Excellent. I'll see you in July. We're only a few months away.
For all the people that were really bent out of shape that there was no trailer, we got those images that showed us a lot of really great stuff. We've now gotten this featurette that just gives you a hint, just a little bit to keep you going. I am in the camp firmly where that's what I want. Like, I don't want a full 3-minute trailer that shows me all of these things where it's like, oh, I wish they would have saved that, or oh, I wish I wouldn't have known that going in, or
yeah.
At least if we're gonna get hit with that trailer and we're gonna have to talk about it here on the show, that's kind of the burden of podcasting, honestly.
Yeah.
But when we do get that trailer, I hope it's a lot closer to the actual release, so that at least it's like, oh, it's fresh in my mind and I'm going into the movie, and it's as opposed to now I sit and I think about it and I dwell on it for 5 months. That's always the hardest part. And then you start speculating. You try not to speculate, and then you build your own headcanon, and it's bad.
I was thinking about this the other day. Like, really, we talked a lot about how in the old days, you used to tie an onion to your belt.
Back in the day. In our day, Ghostbusters 3 was coming in 1993. And
Patrick swore. See, anyways,
Patrick swore.
Little deep cut there.
That's a deep cut. The trailer's gonna be at Comic-Con 2005.
Patrick swore it was happening, and then he swore at us.
Yes, correct.
You know, we talk about how, you know, we didn't really get to talk about it. We only found out little bits and pieces in like Starlog, and it occurred to me the other day, even this urge for a trailer and demand for a trailer and all that, I kind of miss the way it used to be, which was you got your trailer sometimes at the theater, as is usual, as is typical. Not always, but I mean, even now, back then it was kind of a weird, random thing, right? Like, they'd get the movies in and they'd get the trailers, and then the cinemas kind of paired them up, sort of. Now there's like a plan. Like, if you're getting this movie, then you're going to get this trailer in front of it. And all that. But what it occurred to me is, like, when Ghostbusters came out, what I saw of it was the 30 seconds on TV. That's it. And that was 3 weeks before the movie came out, 2 weeks. Like, really, it was, here it comes. Here it is.
I mean, there it goes. I remember that for Ghostbusters 2. I saw the trailer in front of, it was something in 88, and I can't remember what movie it was now, but we saw the trailer, like, oh my God, another Ghostbusters movie. It's finally, like, you know, but
yeah.
You're an 8-year-old kid. That's your first exposure to something is coming. And then you're right. There was nothing until Entertainment Tonight had a spot, a behind the scenes spot, which was usually only a couple of weeks out from the movie release, because obviously they want to get you hyped up for it in a timely fashion, and they don't want you to forget about it. So it was always Entertainment Tonight, Hollywood One-on-One with Scott Patrick would do his junket interviews. And that was the movie. And I know that we have a different news cycle, and I know I don't want to be the old man yelling at the cloud where it's just like, I can't, it was in my day, it was so much better. But there also was something to be said for, you got the one thing, you waited, and then you saw the movie. And there was not this, like, constant need to feed the machine, and the constant entitlement is not the right word for this, but it kind of does feel like entitlement. Like, people are like, where's my trailer? Like, you don't get a trailer. Maybe you don't get another trailer. What do you mean my trailer? We deserve this trailer. Well, no. What if you just go see the movie and enjoy the movie?
My wife, often when we sit down to watch a movie, I'll cycle through it, and I have a vague sense of what a lot of the movies are. You know, I've probably even seen the trailer. I suggest things like, how about we watch this? She's like, oh, great. And then she covers her eyes because she just doesn't even want to see the brief synopsis on the streaming. She's just, you pick. It sounds great. Let's go. Like, she just wants to know nothing. She literally wants to be dropped into the middle of a movie. Well, not middle, but dropped into the waters.
And it's such an amazing experience. Like, for the longest time before I started writing books on the Marvel Cinematic Universe, like, I refused to watch the trailers for the MCU movies, because it was just, when I went and saw the original Iron Man, I had only seen that first trailer, and it was awesome. And past that point, I didn't want to know anything else about him. Going into the movies, yeah. It was great just not knowing anything, and being surprised and not having the jokes ruined by the timing of a trailer and little things like that. But
I have a theory. I don't want to diverge too much, and I know we got to get to some other stuff here, but I have a theory that what we've mistaken as adulthood and kind of like vague cynicism, that we don't fall in love with movies quite as hard as we did when we were kids. I'm now suspicious that perhaps the way media kind of front loads us on movies is also partially to blame for that. Because going back to Maria, I mean, Maria is, I've married my wife who's my age. She is an adult woman. And I do things like, have you heard about Baby Driver? It's Edgar Wright. It's awesome. He thinks out all his stuff. Like, there's going to be so much cinema. I've seen the trailer. Watch this car chase thing in the trailer. Oh, my God. And she's like, okay, let's go see it. Here's a 5-minute
clip that they just released on IGN. You got to watch this. Yeah.
I don't make her watch it. I'm just like, it's really good. I mean, it's the Shaun of the Dead guy. I got to go see it. Let's go see it. She's like, okay, sounds great. And I'm like, it's all very musical and all. She's like, it sounds good. Let's go. So we go, and I come out going, yeah, that's a great Edgar Wright movie. But it's me walking out as an adult going, I saw the thing I wanted and I liked it.
Yeah.
She flipping fell in love with that movie. She's like, can we get it? Like, we got to buy it. Can we watch it again? And that's not the only time that's happened. And like I said, I think her whole approach of I want the movie to surprise me entirely is part of it. I mean, we can only do so much with the fact that we've seen the previous Ghostbusters. We're kind of front-loaded for what a Ghostbusters movie is. But yeah, there's a good reason why, you know, we've promised to try to avoid super spoilers and leaks and stuff like that. Because, yeah, I think,
happens.
Even if you want everything that comes out, I think it's everybody's benefit that we try. And we're saying this on the heels of... I saw there was a blurry background behind Jason in video... Video Highway, and I think that was a video store in my town, actually, Video Highway, but anyways.
I've heard that analogy, like, it's kind of like your graduation day or your wedding day. That's what a lot of people have started comparing movies to, that where it's like, oh, for your whole life, you're building up to your graduation day. Oh, I'm in junior high school, and oh, this sucks. But as soon as I graduate from high school, that's when my life begins. And oh, yeah, I'm going to show all of you guys, when I graduate from high school, I'm going to make my life something different. Oh, when I graduate from high school. And then you get to your graduation day, and it's sort of like, oh, that was it? That's what graduation was? I've built it up this for the last 12 years.
Yeah.
And that's all that it... But if something comes out of the blue and it surprises you and it sweeps you off your feet, it's kind of romantic. It's the movie comes out of nowhere and it's not something you've been building up, and the publicity department has been trying to spoon feed you little things here and there to make sure that you're still interested, and that they've focus grouped and they've been checking it and making sure that if they send this trailer out that everybody's going to go see the movie in July when they think they're going to go see the movie. Like, it's all so calculated and over such a long duration of time that, yeah, I'm with Maria. Like, if we could go back to that, I'm going to go see a movie. Yeah. And I have no idea what it is. Do you remember going to the movie theater with no agenda to see a movie? You just go and be like, well, we're going to go see a movie. What movie? I don't know. We'll see what's playing. And you would go, and at the sixth theater multiplex, you'd be like, oh, that's right, I forgot that movie's out. Let's go see that. And then you go see it, and yeah, it was a surprise.
I remember, back in the day, I remember in university I had a rough week, and I had not seen much about it, maybe again, like flashes on TV and stuff like that, but I knew Mel Brooks had made a Dracula spoof. And
Peter McNichol was in it. Yeah.
I told my buddy Taylor, I'm like, I want to go see the movie. And he's like, no, I don't want to. I'm kind of broke, saving money. I was like, I will buy your ticket. Let's go see a movie, please. And we sat inside, and he continues to like lambaste me for that movie. But I think time's proven him wrong. That is a Mel Brooks classic.
It is. It's a fun movie. It's not his best, but it's a fun movie.
It's not his best, but it's fun. But yeah, but that was exactly what it was. It was like, I need to go see a movie. And I went, and it was there. And, you know, I went in, and I was like, perfect. I've done that before. I saw Seven that way. I had no idea what Seven was. Like, literally had very little idea what Seven was. And then just happened to be, you know, at loose ends at West Edmonton Mall. And so I'm going to go see Seven.
Go see this movie. Yeah.
And actually, you know what? Now that I think about it, I mean, I'm not, there's a reason why this is the Ghostbusters podcast and not me running some sort of weird Seven David Fincher podcast. But I remember the end credits, opening credits, the super stylized opening credits, and then like the running backwards end credits, like just stuff like that. I came out.
Yeah.
That was awesome. I had no idea.
I think you and I have effectively talked ourselves out of doing a podcast until November. Is that what just happened here? Well, no, thanks everybody for joining us. That is the end of this podcast.
No, we got lots of merch stuff to do, and we may have talked ourselves out of looking at the trailer, to be honest.
I mean, it's kind of tough because there's a part of me that wants to see that trailer because we've been waiting so long for a number of years to see another Ghostbusters trailer. But at the same time, it's like, I just want to go in blind to that movie and just enjoy it.
At a minimum, we may have talked ourselves out of dissecting it too. That may be it.
Yeah.
Honestly, I don't know. You and I will have to have an ongoing discussion.
I would open it up to the forum here. Like, I know that people are like, well, I want to hear your breakdown of the trailer. I've seen threads on GB fans where it's like, I need to join a podcast where they dissect every episode of Extreme Ghostbusters. It's like, well, we could do that. But we're also we're bouncing things around on the Deek Peaks. And it's sort of like,
yeah,
if you want a dissection of the trailer, we'll figure something out. We'll find a way to do it. But if you're in that same camp as we are, where it's like, maybe I don't want to, maybe I just want to watch the trailer and enjoy it and then try to like neuralize myself and forget that I saw it, we can totally do that too.
Tell us. You know, the Reitmans have been pretty good, and I'm assuming it's them, you know, some sort of steady hand with Sony. It could still go off the rails that Sony PR goes, nope. Yeah. We got to put the ghost and the secret reveal of Vigo in there to get people into theaters. And that's it all goes.
And everybody objected, but they just went ahead and did it anyway. That's how the relationship between the studio and the filmmakers crumbled to dust. But I don't know.
So far, they've pretty decently, like, let's be honest, when there's a new trailer, what are we going to see? It's the same as it always is. It's going to be the teaser with some of the key points fleshed out a bit more.
Yeah, just that extra bit of hype. And I'm sure that they're not going to tilt their hand too much with as careful and measured as they've been this entire time. Yeah.
Like, I don't think the podcast bet they're not going to put any hint of what the OG original Ghostbusters part is in it at all.
Yeah, if anything, just a hero shot or one line, your Chewie were home is going to be the extent of what you get.
Yeah, probably. I've heard people talk about that. They kind of laid the groundwork with that chunk of video on the internet, on the laptop there from the 80s.
Right.
I'm wondering if that might not be something that expands out too, because that's perfect. You can still reference the original Ghostbusters in the context of the original movies
and play into that mystique in the universe.
Yeah,
too.
Give a little, you know, maybe it's, you know, a newscast, where are they now sort of thing, or some hint of something that happened that, you know, just like if the news was, we never saw it, but what if the news covered, you know, the city suing them and stuff like that? Like, they just, you know, there could be that could be something too. Like, they could literally take the Ghostbusters 2 reference of being sued by the city from the first one, and just, you know, it's now we're watching the 1985 television clip on YouTube.
A current affair
of them referencing it, and that's another way to kind of, you know, or something after Ghostbusters 2 that hints that,
yeah,
you know, where things went.
Them.
And totally. We get super excited about it, and then they still never reveal the principals are doing in the movie.
Yeah, I think that's the way to do it. And if you're trying to avoid those moments being spoiled for you, this Pass the Proton Pack featurette, it does it really well, because it doesn't spoil anything. It's very harmless. So if you're trying to be totally spoiler free and you've actually been skipping over this to avoid us talking about it, you're still safe watching that featurette. So
how did we end up here? Yeah, we started with the featurette and we ended up...
That's what we do here on the Crossroads.
I guess that's true.
Poor Ross May. Our buddy Ross May, we recorded something with him for a future podcast a couple days ago, and I don't think he knew what he was in for, where he's like, okay, gentlemen, let's stay on task. And you and I are like, let's talk about The Mandalorian.
A couple of times he was like, okay, well, we got a lot to go through. And I'm like, Gotta move on. You forgot who we are.
Well, here, let me channel my inner Ross, and okay. We got a lot to go through, so we're going to keep going.
Yeah,
we need to spend a good chunk of time talking about our buddy John Yerkeba, who had also his own featurette come out shortly on the heels of that Pass the Proton Pack featurette. A very awesome kind of like process featurette that shows him drawing the illustration that he did for the Ghostbusters Day t-shirts, which are up on sale still at the Ghostbusters.com official shop. Mm-hmm. But do it now, because as you listen to this, we're getting close to the end of June. Yeah. So if you want any of those shirts from the four artists that did them, go do that now. Mm-hmm. But yeah, just good to see John. I'm sure John's heart was already bursting after Ghostbusters Day. And then for this featurette to come out, and all of the well-deserved praise and the attention that John is getting, I'm just so happy for the dude. So I'm glad to have seen that. And again, it's another look. The official Ghostbusters page is putting stuff out, and it's fan-oriented, but it's a professional fan who has turned his passion into something that he's created, and you can buy through the official website. It's a cool story. You should really go check it out. And I just want to name drop John, because he's a lovely dude and I love that guy.
He's I had a bad joke about he's gunning for not an EGOT, he's going for an Egon.
Dad.
Come on. It's not even a dad joke, it's a lazy dad joke. I got halfway through it and went, that makes no sense. Moving on.
Just one other thing, not much to talk about here. Ghostbusters was well represented on Jeopardy. Corporate synergy at its finest. Thank you, Sony Pictures, Home Entertainment, and Television Distribution. Jeopardy had two categories, Ghost and Busters. Obviously, all of them were either Ghost. One of the clues was like, this Marvel Comics anti-hero runs around on a motorcycle with a flaming head. What is Ghost Rider? Anyway, so that was cool to see. And as we mentioned, Home Entertainment, some sales are still going on as you listen to this for the original films and real Ghostbusters. Not extreme Ghostbusters, still very curiously absent. And you know what? I'm going to skip ahead, Chris, before we get into Hughes and Thrall, the Ghostbusters 2 Randy Edelman score, just to kind of settle this. Yes, there was supposed to be an announcement. Yes, we were supposed to be able to pre-order it for Ghostbusters Day. Yes, the world is still a little weird, as much as we want to think that things are back to normal. And it was delayed due to COVID production issues. So it is still coming. Don't worry. It has not been canceled. But it's just running a little bit behind. My guess is it will probably be here for the holiday season, or at least closer to Ghostbusters Afterlife's release.
Yeah, could be kind of tied into Sony's loose Halloween co-opting of
You put that pre-order in on Halloween and you get it the first or second week of November, then you go see Ghostbusters Afterlife on 11/11, and
makes sense.
Oh boy, what a fun October, November, December it's going to be. So stay tuned. For everybody that was really disappointed about that announcement, I was there with you because I was ready to have that in my hands, but it will be worth the wait. Again, one of those things that we never thought would happen, so just take it. Take the delay and take it with a smile. But speaking of music, Chris, this is kind of the meat of our discussion at the 30-minute mark. Another Ghostbusters theme song, or demo for a theme song, has been revealed, and it is not one of the ones that we were already familiar with. This is kind of fun. I love discovering new things about the movie that we love and have dissected now for way too long. So Ray Parker Jr. famously says, when I was handed the Ghostbusters assignment, there had been 80 or no less than 80 attempts at making a theme song for this, and they all failed. Nobody could do it. Part of that is Ray Parker Jr. telling a good story, but part of that is also true. There were not 80, but there were a good handful, maybe less than a dozen, of these demos that were created by various people throughout Hollywood, musicians that were trying to take a stab at Ivan Reitman's direction to create a Ghostbusters theme song that incorporated the word Ghostbusters, which is very difficult. Yeah. And we know one, which we've heard in the teaser trailer, and we have still not really been able to identify, which is that whoa, 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 Ghostbusters, that one, which for the longest time, I thought that was the Hughes and Thrall track, but that was not the Hughes and Thrall track. They said, no, that's not us. Then we got a hint of it in, I think it's called Wild Night, which is the track that was on the Show West reel that for legal reasons had to be removed on the Steelbook edition. But if you go to YouTube and Twitter and all sorts of places, it keeps popping up. So you can find it pretty easily. Spook Central, Paul's got it. It's kind of another bouncy track that didn't really incorporate Ghostbusters quite as much. But when we heard that, we're like, that's the Hughes and Thrall song. And Pat Thrall, at some point, somebody sent it to him, and he's like, that's not us. That's not our song. Mm. To which everybody, including you and I, we went, what is the Hughes and Thrall song? We know that Hughes and Thrall did a demo, and we've heard too, yep. and we haven't heard. So what is their track? And people reached out to them. They said, nah, we don't have it. It's been lost to the sands of time. Whatever that demo track is, those... that reel-to-reel is just completely mush. Like, it's all one piece, and there's no way you could ever play it again. Lo and behold, last week, Pat Thrall, who has discovered SoundCloud, has been uploading rarities, B-sides, demos, all sorts of stuff. And if you're familiar, Hughes and Thrall, friends of Dan Aykroyd, ended up doing some tracks for the Dragnet soundtrack. They are the writers of City of Crime, infamous for Dan Aykroyd and Tom Hanks rapping at the end of the Dragnet film. But they were brought in to do a demo, and we've heard that Ivan Reitman gave one listen to it and said, nope, that's not it. Give me another one. And we've heard it now. Yep. And, well, we've heard it now. What's the best way to do this, Chris? You think should I play just a little snippet of it here and then
play a
we
little
can
snippet just in case
it?
Somebody hasn't heard it?
Okay, it's all right.
Very possible that somebody hasn't heard it.
Yeah, I mean, if you're on social media, this was like the talk of social media or Ghostbusters social media last week. But just in case,
run a verse and a chorus there.
Yeah, here's a little bit of it. So I'm not going to lie, there are shades of Dragnet already in there. Like, I can see the pagans in their sheepskin pants, their sheep leggings, dancing to this song.
It, to me, has a very Thomas Dolby's Weird Science kind of vibe to it. Like,
yes.
You could tell it's from that era of, like, you know, a wacky science comedy kind of.
It's got that,
it is. It's the same tempo, the same energy.
Yeah, it has that varied tempo where it kind of it has that kind of like bouncy pop tempo, and yeah. then it sort of breaks down for a second, then it has the bouncy pop tempo, and it just doesn't have the flow that the Ray Parker Jr. song has. It's not the earworm catchy Ray Parker Jr. song, that's for sure.
Yeah.
But certainly, I mean, different. I can hear it playing over end credits.
Yep.
I can hear it playing as like a little snippet of a theme song at the beginning of the movie. It's not a montage song. It's not something that you can set that beautiful montage in the middle of the movie to.
It's a great little 80s bop. Like, I've listened to it several times, and the OE OE O is very catchy. It gets stuck in your head and all that. But yeah, it's not. It's not quite there. And I mean, I don't actually. It's unfair to Pat Thrall and partner there that. Because we have Ray Parker's Juniors, we've internalized it, you know, we've associated with the movie and all that. So kind of like grading on a you know, terrible curve. I don't think it's super fair to kind of compare that way. But yeah, he, like I said, I'm not trying to diminish it at all by saying it's very Weird Science-esque. Like, because it's what I mean to say is it's a very similar kind of 80s, you know, pop track. I don't even know if it counts as a pop track, but
you could see Hughes and Thrall handing this over to like Morris Day and the Time or something. Like it has that same kind of like energy to it where,
yeah, I think there's something about the 80s that there was a kind of a tempo and an energy that was consistent in the 80s that you hear it and you're like, yep. So like you think of like, Caddyshack and stuff like that. Again, I mean, that's a very different song stylistically, but it's that same just driving, spastic on the dance floor kind of track there.
Yeah, you see like Robert Downey Jr. like flailing his arms out to it during a dance montage kind of thing. Yeah,
yeah.
The funny thing when I listened to this, the snarky joke that came into mind was, okay, so Ray Parker Jr.'s song comes out, Huey Lewis is like, "You stole my song. That's I Want a New Drug." I could picture if this went from demo to an actual studio recording, Prince, had he written 1999, prior to this song coming out, would have been like, "Hey, that, that's my 1999 thing. You stole that from me." Like, there would have still been a lawsuit. There still would have been that whole thing that went down. But yeah, I think it's, again, you're right. It's indicative of just the music from the 80s and what was popular. And this is kind of that sort of alt pop, I don't want to say new wave cause it's not quite new wave, but it's still in that sort of alt Oingo Boingo-y kind of, vein. And
yeah.
I want to give Pat Thrall his opportunity to speak for himself here on his SoundCloud. He says, "This is the demo that Hughes, Thrall, and Peter Aykroyd pitched for the movie." I forgot that Peter Aykroyd also wrote this part. He says, "It was declined. There has been a version posted on YouTube claiming to be the Hughes, Thrall demo, but it wasn't. Here for the first time, it is finally posted. The guy that mixed it had been awake for a week on cocaine. It is one of the worst mixes ever." And as you heard in the little snippet, yeah, he's not wrong. Like the vocals are just crunched down and you can't hear anything. But
yeah.
But also I have no idea where Pat Thrall pulled this from. Maybe this is some sort of like a reel-to-reel tape that he's had in his studio that he just came across in the closet or something. So it could have degraded pretty heavily too since then. It's so cool to hear. And I think it came on the heels of us having the discussion with Ross. I don't want to give away what that discussion is. I want that to be Ross's big reveal. Mm-hmm. But we started talking about alternate universes and where things could have gone in certain ways. And hearing these little things, like reading the old scripts, hearing these demos, looking at storyboards and things like that, where you kind of see where the movie evolved from, is still one of the things that I really enjoy doing. Like I love dissecting the making of this movie almost 40 years later. It's kind of insane to be doing that, but we still need to figure out who did those other demos and we still need to hear those other demos in their entirety. So Adam, hey, I don't know who else out there has the detective know-how to figure this out. Maybe somebody at some point will be able to talk to the Sony Music Group, and they can go through all the music cue sheets and figure it out for us. Or maybe Peter Bernstein. Maybe Peter Bernstein would know. But at any rate, man, that was cool. I loved hearing that. I loved seeing everybody's responses to it. And I love learning things about the movie that we didn't know before. That's kind of what the beauty of this all is. Let's do that instead of dissecting the trailer. Let's learn something new about the 84 film.
I haven't had time yet, but I'm a little curious then about, like I said, it's going to take some time to go back and find some old interviews and quotes and stuff like that. But I'm really curious about things like, there is a, yeah, who can you call? There is the line, who can you call?
Yeah.
And funnily enough, Ray Parker Jr., that's one of the things he says at the end of his song. Exact same thing, not who are you going to call. He says, who can you call?
Well, and he takes credit having watched TV late at night and seeing the Exterminator commercial and thinking like, oh, the jingle would need to be who you're going to call. Is there a world where he heard this and was inspired by it and it became the predecessor to the theme song that we now know and love? That's also true.
Yeah. Or the other thing is like, for example, did Dan or maybe Peter have notes that got handed around, like they hadn't seen the movie, right? Like,
it's true. You couldn't go screen the movie. You just had like, here's all these things. Yeah.
What was it distilled? And is Peter part of Peter's credit? Like, did he write some of this stuff? Like the who you're gonna call, the who can you call? That, like I said, that may have been a consistent note to both Ray Parker Jr. and Hughes and Thrall. You know, they're going to have a TV commercial and all that. Because this whole thing plays a lot like the TV commercials talking at you, right? Like,
yeah.
Again, he references Hughes and Thrall's talk more at the ghost, whereas Ray Parker Jr. talked more at the person who's having trouble with the ghost. But there's a lot of overlap, right? Like, that's, you know, true, being stuck. Yeah. There's somebody living in your house that shouldn't be there. Like, you want to get rid of them?
That was lost on me until you just mentioned it. But yeah, this whole song is written as if the ghost is listening to it. Like, you got it coming, buddy. I don't care if this used to be your house. I don't care if this used to be your office. You got to get out of here.
The choruses are talking to the people who own the house. It's like Ghostbusters. We believe you. It's the Ghostbusters talking to, you know, Ghostbusters. Shout out to Jim Maritato, by the way.
He transcribed
everything here, but so I'm just reading off it, like, you know, Ghostbusters, we trap and put him away, right? Like, so the chorus is all the Ghostbusters and their commercial, but all the verses are talking to the ghosts, right? actually, no, verse 2 is actually kind of still talking to the person, but verse 3 is talking at the ghost.
That's right. Yeah.
Like, which world are you gonna live in? Make up your mind. Like, and if you don't, you know. It's actually, there's the weird line, we're coming to get you, don't be afraid. It's like, there's a line here about trapping me. Okay, I guess I'm not afraid.
Yeah. I'm trying to pull it up now so I can see it, but there was a line, and I didn't catch it until Vink Maniac transcribed it, but it was like, do you want to be a chicken or a man? And I was like, oh, that's kind of the movie really is, but okay. Yeah.
I can see the structure now. So yeah, verse 1 and 2 is the commercial talking at the people, right? This is why it really feels like there may have been notes. An apparition walks through your wall, right? Walking through
how we get to the who you're gonna call. The who you're gonna call is only in there once, right?
The who can you call?
Yeah.
Actually, the whole verse ends in the same rhyme structure there. I do like the line, he lives in the kitchen, but he died in the hall. I'm like, I'm stereotypical Italian pizza chef. Mwah, that's beautiful. That one made me, and it's right at the start of the song. It made me laugh so hard. I really got to get the other lyrics. I have, from hearing this one, I now suspect that yeah, there was some stuff fed to them. I mean, obviously, it's not a huge revelation, but it's very clear from reading the lyrics of this one that premises and lines and all that were kind of fed at to the songwriters, who then kind of transposed it into their own style or sort of thing. But yeah, the first two verses is there it is. Verse two, could be a demon or a bump in the night, right? Like, so the bump in the night thing again is similar to a line in Ray Parker Jr. By the way, nobody listening get confused that I'm saying Ray Parker Jr. ripped off Hughes and Thrall. What I'm saying is that I think there was a lot of just notes fed to them that were the same notes went out to all the, and there's no way we're going to, the only way I can back that up is, for the love of God, we got to find that one that was used in the trailer. So
and find out who did it. That's the other. Yeah.
So verse one and verse two is talking at, is talking to the customer, but verse three is talking at the ghost, and it comes after the breakdown where they're talking at the ghost. You're gone now and it's time to throw you out. We don't care if you used to own this house. We don't care if you used to live here once. We don't care if this used to be your room. And then it goes into the rest of verse three. Like, you know, I don't know. Part of me was initially being kind of not hating on the song, but I was just kind of like, oh, well, this is very 80s. Again, compared to Ray Parker Jr. put very much his kind of his Detroit spin on it, which makes it stand out a lot from, a lot of the synth rock pop that was big in the early to mid 80s there. But the more I said, it's catchy. Like that OE OE O is just still stuck in my head.
Yeah, it has shades really... of the Run DMC version. Now that I think about it, like hearing you talk about the lyrics, it's like, well, that's kind of very reminiscent of the Run DMC rap, but yeah.
It's, I really kind of like it. It's not, it is a demo, and I kind of wonder how much it might have tightened up.
Oh, sure. Yeah. I mean, with some revisions and a studio recording, like, release the Snyder cut. No, release the Hughes and Thrall cut. Let's see what this could have become.
That first verse is, an apparition walks through your wall. He lives in the kitchen, but he died in the hall. Who do you talk to? Who can you call? Ghostbusters will take care of it all. So good.
Now I see why some of the songs in Nothing But Trouble became the way that they were too, but that's a whole other story.
Well, yeah, it's
all Peter Aykroyd, if I remember correctly. Yeah.
Yeah. Right. So it's, so credit where credit is due in the breakdown of this. I think that might be Peter Aykroyd there. It's good. I just wish we had a better copy. I actually spent a lot of time trying to wash it through a bunch of,
It's tough to dig much of anything out of there. Yeah.
I kind of softened up, kind of those top out peaks that it had, and tried to kind of fluff up some of the bass a bit more. And there's only so much you can do, but
It's tough. But let's hear from you all out there. I'm curious. It was very fun watching everybody's responses to this song, including Pat Thrall's on his own, being self-deprecating about the mix and everything. I wonder how he kind of feels about it, all things considered. But yeah, how did you guys feel about the song? Hit us up, let us know, send us a voicemail, send us a message on the Twitter or the Instagram or the Facebook. And we want to know. Sorry, Chris, I got to cut it short because I do want to give us some time just to throw a quick shout out to our pal, Shogren, who has a show coming out in November called Yes Have Some. We'll let the other guys have some words with him about that, which will be at the Sugar Mint Gallery. Check it out. We'll put it up in our social feeds. He is a wonderful guy, awesome artwork. He's working on a couple kids' books now. But check out that art gallery once it comes out.
Go back to last fall when we had him on, and he actually kind of hinted that this was in the works.
And it was COVID a great interview with him. Delayed him. So check that out.
Great interview with him that you should go back and listen to.
And then speaking of fan-made stuff, we do have a couple of fan films that came out. Go check those out. 13 Doors of Shandor, which I think is still in the works but coming soon. trying to fill some gaps between the movies. Ghostbusters Reanimated, which to my knowledge is one of the first sort of traditional, quote-unquote, hand-drawn animated fan films that we've seen. Go check that out. A lot of work went into those, so please do that. And merch-wise, we missed out on the Micheline Pit. I hope I said that right, but they've got a clothing line coming out next month in July, August.
If today is Monday the 21st when it drops, that is the day they said they'd be announcing it, wasn't it? Or was it July 21st? Am I super confused now?
It's been announced. Well, they've announced it with the photos, and I don't know. It's a very small niche boutique clothing line where there's like Stay Puft dresses and some Hawaiian shirts and stuff like that. It's all kind of grassroots, and it kind of came through social media. Like, we got looped into multiple posts. So
yeah.
So stay tuned. If that's, especially the Hawaiian shirts, the look kind of tiki themed. Stay tuned. I bet they will be of interest to a lot of people out there.
Shout out to Evelyn 13 from the Ghostbusters British Columbia, because she's the one who hit me to it. And those dresses are 100% Evelyn 13. I've been in LA. Was it for FanFest or was it for the? No, it might have been for the premiere or something like that. She was down and she went off to Disneyland, and she like full on, did the, what do you call it? The dressing up for Disneyland that people
bounding.
Do
Yeah.
Yeah. Something like that. And any vintage style dresses and stuff like that, especially the more pop culture, flavored ones and all that, very much her thing. So she was, this is probably one of those weird times for her where she's like, Ghostbusters should be nowhere near this thing. And this fashion line in store I'm aware of, but there it is. Okay, I should go tell that nerd, hey Stuart, hey nerd, there's a thing going on, nerd. It started out as me thanking her and ended with me pretending to be her mocking me. I really need to see a therapist, I think. Anyways.
let me reel you back in, Stuart. I don't know where you are right now, but I'm gonna save you.
I'm checking now. It launches June 21st today.
Day, there we go.
If you're listening on the day it drops, yeah.
So
head to Micheline Pit. So MicheliniePitt.com. All one word. There you go.
Check him out. Yeah.
Some purses too. I am 100%. I. I posted it, and Micheline's online, and she gave it a thumbs up and said thank you. And I'm like, fair warning, I need to know how big the No Ghost logo purse is, because I really have this thing about wanting to put a canteen in it and make it a canteen holder. So, anyways, go now, buy lots. Go.
Bye now.
Don't wait another minute. Pick up your phone and call the professionals.
Ghost Stoppers.
I'm sorry. We'll do it again.
We want to hear from you. Leave us a voicemail on our calling line at 470-242-4742. That's 4702-GBHQIC. We also have a Facebook page.
You do?
And Twitter accounts.
Friend is dead.
No kidding. Just give me the address.
Search Facebook for
Ghostbusters.
Interdimensional Cross Rip.
On Twitter, look for Troy at Ghostbusters HQ and Chris at Proton Charger.
What the hell are you doing?
If you like what you hear, please take a moment to give us a review on iTunes. Be sure to recommend us to your friends.
That makes good sense. Don't wait another minute. Pick up your phone and call the professionals.
Once again, our call-in line is 4702-GBHQIC.
That'll do it. Thanks very much, Ray.
All right, Chris, we did it. Somehow we reeled it in. We brought it in under an hour. Barely. But what do you got in terms of final thoughts this week?
Nothing. Just a happy belated Father's Day there, pal.
Oh, hey, to you as well. That's
Thank
true.
You.
For everybody listening to this, it'll be the day after Father's Day. And I have I think we're going to get breakfast burritos. That's the only thing that I know we're doing.
Yeah,
it.
we're talking in future tense about something that happened in the
it's
past.
It's very
year, which
weird.
Is always weird.
Call the TVA. We're anomalies. I don't know what's happening.
I was asked what I wanted to do, and I couldn't think of much. But what I think I may end up doing is we're gonna get up. We're gonna figure out breakfast somehow. I'm still not 100% keen on going into restaurants, and I haven't checked.
Yeah.
But, you know, we may, if it looks like, you know, we're two booths separate from people or something like that, you know, maybe we'll hit an IHOP or something. But the plan is some sort of breakfast, and then I got a couple places in mind. There's an antique mall, one of those places where people, like, you know, rent a stall in a larger building sort of thing. You ever been to anything like that? I don't know if LA must have, LA must have something like that. But yeah, like, it's just, I've been there before, and it's, I know there's a lot of antique-y stuff and all that sort of thing, but there's also a lot of, like, guys that sell old collectibles and toys and all that. And I've seen some Ghostbusters, and it's always fun too, because they bring in new stuff. So that's what I want to do. That's what I'm going to do for my Father's Day. Is I'm going to have my mask on. I'm half vaccinated. I'm going to wander around in a dusty old antique mall, and see if I can maybe find myself some, I don't know, real Ghostbusters glasses. Or
find something that you can mark the day with by purchasing.
My plan is to walk away with at least one Ghostbusters thing. And my backup is if the mall doesn't have it, we'll swing by Toy Traders in Langley, and I'll buy something new instead.
Yeah,
some
new
Ghostbusters thing.
Nice. Oh man, yeah, that'll be fun. That's right. I forgot you get your second shot here pretty soon too. You're coming up on that, right?
They're talking about, it's about timing and dates and all that sort of thing. I don't know how long between the first one and I'm coming up. It's been a month, so maybe. But they all, people talk like, oh, you need to leave it for 3 months. And I was like, ugh. We're trying to go save a grandmother from some sort of cabin fever induced rage. So
bouncing off the walls. Yeah.
So I'm going to have to, I got to figure something out, but you're getting pretty close.
Yeah. Oh, excellent. Hopefully everybody out there is still, I know that here in LA, things are opening up again. Just be mindful, be careful, be safe.
Be smart.
Be smart about things. Don't just, things are not quite normal. Everybody's like, oh, everything's back to normal. Like, is it though?
Is it though? So, particularly since in, you know, usual hubris style, just as everybody's like, well, things are getting back to better and more people getting vaccinated, and so we should just kind of dial it back. And
then the doctors are like, we've all seen a lot of horror movies. We know when you think that Jason is dead and in the river,
the boring science version of that is happening already, because one of the variants is like, it's nailing people that only got their first shot. You know, I only got mine a month ago. They say it takes, you know, could take a couple of months to hit the maximum efficacy with even with the second shot. And I only got the one a month ago, and they're like, oh, here's a variant, and oh yeah, it's it's punching some people in the nose who got their first shot. And it's like, oh great, okay, so let's just stay the course.
Everybody be careful. That's all I want to say. Just please be careful.
I mean, if the whole wash your hands thing went out the window, we're just begging for it. Oh my God.
That's true. Yeah. So take everything in stride. Please be careful. We all want to make it to November and see that movie together in a theater. Yes. That's the goal here.
Let's
keep that in mind.
November. Yeah.
Yes, please. All right. Well, next week, we're getting into July. We're going to start getting into some fun stuff. We got another Deke Peaks coming around the corner. We're going to start getting back into some building.
Yeah.
I'm so excited. I hope my laptop holds up when we're doing video recording. We'll figure that out as we go.
Speaking of Deke Peaks, if you've ever been curious about getting the shirts and all that, or picking up any of our patches, now is the time. Because without getting into too many details, a little bit of a technical upgrade would never go amiss for the Ghostbusters cross rip. So buy some swag.
Yes. Yes. Please buy swag, because somebody needs a new computer all of a sudden.
You know what? You would never ask. I will ask flat out right. A lot of the overhead and a lot of the hardware abuse and all that is on your side of things. And both of us are very kind of laid back about the whole, we don't really have a monetization model. That's not what any of this is about sort of thing. But, you know, we put some merch and some patches, and you put the logo on some things, and we got the Deke Peak shirts and all that sort of thing. And we've all been kind of, you know, If you want it, cool. I'm here to say, if you want it, really seriously think about it, because I we've been doing this. Let's put it this way: we've been doing this since 2015. Computer hardware does not normally exist that long without something falling off along the way. So it's
and literally something fell off of my machine from 2011 that's been holding this podcast together.
We're still happy to be laissez-faire about it. We, you know, no pressure or anything. But if you've been listening, if you've been enjoying, and you want to keep listening and enjoying, well, you know, pick yourself up a Deep Peak shirt or a one of our Larry King Mooglies. Every little bit
helps. We are supported by listeners like you. We're going to do a fundraiser here if I can't pull up the bread to buy the new laptop in a month or two here. But check it.
That means I got to start designing a book bag. Isn't that what CBS does?
Yeah, exactly. We'll get you a lovely tote bag at the $10 donation. And
I will 100% do that. I'm threatening now. Go buy some cool stuff or we're doing a fundraiser. I'm making book bags.
We're doing totes and CDs, just like NPR. GhostbustersHQ.net/shop. That's where you can get everything. Or check us out on Etsy. That's where everything is up to. I love you, laptop. Don't fail on me now. We haven't been talking about you this whole time. Everything is cool. Goose Frob. Anyway, everybody, until next week, we'll see you all on the other side.
Thanks for joining the Ghostbusters Interdimensional Crossrip. Visit us at protoncharging.com, ghostbustershq.net, and stillplayingwithtoys.net.
That used to be one of my two favorite shows.
Everything you're doing is bad. I just want to let you know that.
We'd like to get a sample of your brain tissue.
Next week, though, Careless Pets. We're so cool.
It is stuck in my head.
It is pretty catchy. Like, once you listen to it a couple of times, on the first listen, you're like, ooh, oh boy, that's rough.
Now you're dancing around the floor.